In this video, we will learn about unit testing in iOS development. We will learn what is a unit test, what makes a good unit test, what is a good amount of code coverage, and more. Stay tuned. Hey Code Crew, my name is Michaela Carrant. I am a full-time iOS developer and freelancer. Let's get started learning about unit testing. First of all, what is unit testing? Unit testing is testing a unit of code, meaning single functionality. So what we want to do is validate that a piece of code works as we expect it, meaning when we input something, we want it to always output the exact same thing every single time. By confirming that the code works as we expect it every time, we know that we can prevent what's called regression. So regression is when you go and add a new feature into your code, but then you somehow mess up the first feature that you built. So when you have your entire first feature covered in unit tests, when you go to add that new feature for the second part, then when you run your unit tests, you know for a fact the first feature, feature one, did not break, which is great because now you don't have to go back and continually like check to make sure everything works. And with unit testing, these can be integrated with what is called CI/CD. So this is continuous integration or continuous delivery or deployment. This allows you, when you work in a team, to continually test your code. So when your friend or coworker goes to make their feature while you're also making a feature at the same time, then using CI/CD, when you go to merge your code together, you can make sure that your code didn't break their code and that theirs did not break yours by continually running your unit test as you're currently like merging your code together. What are some best practices for unit testing? The first best practice is your unit tests should not rely on any external source. So this means it should not rely on your database and they should not rely on your network connection, because those are something that like you just cannot control. As opposed to your code, it should always do the exact same thing in every single situation. Your unit tests should be automated. So this means they can run in the background when you have like CI/CD set up, which is continuous integration, continuous delivery, which just means how you can continually combine code with other coworkers or other teammates. CI/CD is a very big topic, completely out of the scope of this course, but they can be automated. So basically every time you merge your code together with your coworkers, your unit tests will run. The way to structure your unit test is using the given, when, then format. So the given is what you're actually going to be testing. And then the when is your condition for what you're doing. And then the then is what should happen in the end. So we will go more in depth with that structure when we actually practice writing a unit test. And lastly, the best practice for unit testing is what percentage of code coverage should you have for your project? So with code coverage, it means how much of your code is covered by unit tests, meaning does your unit test test all the different things that your code does? So I asked this question on Twitter, what is the best practice for this? Because it varies by project or by company, because some companies say everything must be unit tested. So that could be like a banking application. Because with banking, you're dealing with money and you want your unit tests to cover every single thing. You don't want your money to all of a sudden disappear because of a software bug. So that is like your worst case scenario is if a bug like inadvertently charges people money or loses them money. Or a different application you could make, like one that I made when I first started, is a trivia application. Whereas none of it is unit tested, like at all. So if there's a bug in the code, it's just a normal basic trivia app. It's okay. It won't really like affect anything in somebody's life or like hurt anybody in any way. So the best practice for code coverage for unit testing, I would say would probably be closer to like 60% plus, meaning over half of your code base has unit tests covered. So this would mean that you know at least half of your code base will always work the exact same way when you run your unit tests. But this goes back to one of the big principles, which is have quality over quantity. So this could mean you have some kind of function, either a class or some kind of class functionality, or like a specific function that kind of does a lot of things. You want to make sure that you test your very specific piece of code and it does the right thing, and it always does the right thing in every single kind of scenario, as opposed to writing a bunch of tests that kind of don't do anything. And we'll get into that a little bit later. But always think quality over quantity. The last thing with unit testing is there's a concept called TDD, or test-driven development. So this would mean that you actually write your unit test before you write your code. So why would you kind of do something like this? And how does it work? So how it works is you write a test that fails, meaning your test like does not pass because you have not written the code for that feature. So you write a failing test, so it's red, because red is denoted by like it did not pass, you know, red light. And then the last point is to make your test green and make it pass. So we write the minimum amount of code that we need for that feature, we run our unit test, and the unit test now passes. And then the last step of TDD is to go back and refactor. So this whole process is called TDD, but it's also referred to as red-green refactor. Some of the benefits of TDD are that you will have better code quality because you're writing the test before writing your code, and this helps you prevent regressions in your code. There's a few common terms to know when learning about unit testing. There's mocking, stubbing, and faking. What this really just means is that we are replacing our code in some way, shape, or form because we can't unit test it. Meaning, like when we unit test a network request, we can't directly unit test it because of the fact we are relying on something else, meaning the network. We are relying on something other than our code. So we accomplish a unit test by doing mocking, stubbing, and faking. Mocking is when we simulate the behavior of real objects. Stubbing is creating a predictable input to functionality that's being tested. And faking is a working implementation that's different than production. And in doing this, it may decrease complexity. So let's first look at faking, because all of these are very similar. Faking is when we have a working implementation, but it's different than production. So this would mean we could, instead of saving data to our database, we could save data to user defaults or to in memory, because this would essentially work, but we are completely changing what the actual implementation of it is because we want to simplify it. Let's look at the difference between stubbing and mocking. So stubbing is what we think of when we want to make some kind of fake response, because that's confusing because there's already a word for faking, but it is a predictable response. So we can use protocols to switch out the response of something and instead stub it, meaning give something that we know will happen. So stubbing is when we give a canned response to something. So we can make a protocol and have the protocol, you know, require some functions. And then what we do is we switch it out with a different object for our unit testing. And we will go more in depth later, which is why it's probably still confusing. And with mocking, what we can do is change the implementation. So for example, we have a system that sends an email. In a unit test, we won't want to actually send emails to our users. So what we will do instead is switch out the behavior, so simulate behavior of the real object, and instead just call the callback and say, hey, the email was sent, as opposed to actually going about and sending an email. So this helps isolate our test and not rely on anything external. Today, we talked about unit testing. We learned what is unit testing, how do we know if we're writing good unit tests, some best practices, and some common words when we talk about this subject. We learned what is a good amount of code coverage. We learned what is TDD, test-driven development. And then lastly, what is the difference between faking, mocking, and stubbing? So I will see you in the next video to actually implement these concepts.